paper, her talk is called Personal Voice, Body, Material. AK will be speaking about four particular works and the kind of interplay between these works. Ideas of intersexuality, sound, materials, presence, the body, being an artist, being a woman. AK lives and works in Oslo and Lofoten, in Norway, and her practice spans a variety of mediums. She's exhibited extensively. I was delighted to see the Icon Gallery, for instance, and I'm very happy to have you here today and to be talking and to kick off as our keynote. Thank you very much indeed.
Thank you. Thank you for inviting me. I've been more or less living 20 years between London and Lofoten until last autumn, so it's very nice to be here in London. I have a 5-6 minutes, a short text I will read for you, and then, like you mentioned, Joe, concentrate on four works only. Personal, voice, body, material. I had these four words on top of my Word document in my computer. Then, when I started writing this short introduction, the four words did not make sense when I separated them. They became one body. I will share four works with you in this talk that mirror why the words can't be separated. I'm an artist. I'm not the composer, not the writer, but a visual artist. I create works that comes from an idea, a concept from the very beginning. And one work leads to another. It just never stops. The space, the site, the country, a body, the season and temperature is all part of my material. And it seems to involve, again and again, one major thought I carry with me. How do I find balance in the world we are living in, here and now? Some works will be finished and can be seen or listened to in an exhibition and so on by others. Some are left in the drawer, and some might just stay a rumor of something. So what is personal? Is the body personal? Is the voice personal? Is one material more personal than another? For a long time, it was an issue for me that my body was private and extremely personal. If my own body was part of a film or image, I told even the curator, writer or gallerist, don't tell anyone it's me. It's obviously a body, but don't tell anybody it's my body. I took care to never show my face so no one could see the body was actually me. I edited my face away from the body. Why then use my own body? Of course, it's cheap and very practical. It's closest to me. But what does it give the work that I use my own body? 2 years ago, I made a rather big publication with the title Please Return by, I hope you have it in the library here. In the first pages, the editor Gabi Hartl wanted to start the publication with several scans of pages from my sketchbooks. She discovered the books on top of a shelf in my studio as I just stacked them there when they are all full. I have about 100 from the last 30 years, and I had hardly ever reopened them, never looked back and therefore never shown those pages to anybody. But I had never lost one. I always carry one with me, like now actually. So I'm not the woman with small handbags. It's all drawings and handwriting with soft pencil. It was interesting when you mentioned the pencil earlier, Joe. But when Hartl wanted to open the sketchbooks, scan them, and start our large publication with those scans, I felt more exposed than if I was showing my naked body. The feeling of nakedness comes from the fact that I find it is such a short way from my mind to the pencil. What is my body then? Paul Valéry writes in his essay, The Problem of the Three Bodies. The first body is the favorite object that is present, although our knowledge of it may be variable and subject to illusion. Like everything that is inseparable from the moment. Everybody calls this object my body, but we do not give it the name in ourselves that is in it. We speak of it to others as a thing that which belongs to us, but for us it is not altogether a thing and belongs to us less than we belong to it. Our second body is the body others see, and that is more or less revealed to us in the glass, mirror, or in portraits. It's the one we hang stuff on. It's the one love sees. It's ignorant of pain, knowing only the grimace of pain. There is then a third body, but this one, except in our mind, lacks unity. Out of it are removed masses of various dimensions which have been fitted in rather neatly. These are sponges, vessels, tubes, and so on. This is what you don't see at all, parts and bits and cells, but we understand it is there. Paul Valéry helped me rethink when I read this, not so long time ago. It was a revelation to come to that understanding that the representation of my own body is disconnected from my personal, intimate experience of self. But the voice and the handwriting in my sketchbook was not. The pencil, the writing from my pencil in a closed sketchbook felt to be more personal, my body, than my physical body. Now these pages are in the publication, accepted slowly. The pages of the sketchbooks are out there. It is a whole concept much larger than my so-called visual and physical body. Then the voice. After working with other people's voices, friends and family, but hardly ever actors, I now work with my own voice. The voice is a part of my body. The voice as a part of my body tells things I can't find in Valéry's three bodies. It was a move I only made a few years back to share my voice in the work and actually state voice, aka Dolven. By using my own voice, I can hear it when I'm on my own. I don't need a mirror or a camera for that. The voice felt like a stranger at first, but has become a friend. To use my own voice and the handwriting became a way to accept my so-called body in my work. It's all one person, one material. It's me, the artist. I will show you, talk a bit about the work Amazon. It's a 16 millimeter film, and it's edited. It's 1 minute 34 seconds, and I'm showing it to you, the 1 minute 34 seconds. But it's edited more than 150 times. This is stills from the film. I can say that I studied archery. And it's edited conceptually after Shostakovich's Spring Quartet. You probably know the Russian composer Shostakovich. He went to Dresden in the 1960s, this beautiful city of culture, and saw it totally bombed by the Allies. And in a few days, he wrote this Spring Quartet, which I know well. I'm going to play a minute or so from that Spring Quartet. In the end, the film is mute. So it's just conceptually edited after his String Quartet. You probably understand it when you see the film later. Why film? I also work with video or different techniques. But in this case, the physicality of the film cut it physical. And it's such a physical work, it felt natural to use the physical film. It's very much part of the material. And of course, when you see the work, you hear also the projector. In this case, I think that's important that you have it. it's picture, 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 picture. It's also related to Shostakovich. Yeah, as long as I can. You probably know John Giorno, some of you, do you? Yeah? How many know John Giorno? Yeah. He's an American beat poet. A friend of mine. And we met in Lofoten and had long walks and talks. And then in New York and had walks and talks. And this piece, Ja, as long as I can, was a piece I thought of since a while and was going to use actors. I just had a test with that. But then it happened that I should do it with a friend. And part of the piece is that it's actually in the meantime become, it's sound work, but it's also become a performance. And here is in Rio Cinema in Dalston. So it's shown quite a bit in, and here we have John and me looking for the green ray where I'm from, where I have my home and studio in Lofoten, and here we are in New York. What we did, we went to a studio in New York, so I traveled all the way to Lofoten, to New York, and we hired this really professional studio and editors and so on. We should have this, say the word, ja, together on top of each other. But then I went into the studio first, where he's sitting here now, and just started to say the word ja as a test. And ja is like yes, it's in German and Norwegian, and it means yes. And it happened just that, to be 22 minutes. And then I went out. And then John did the same, and it was also approximately 22 minutes. And then we show in and do it together. But then we said, wait a minute, put them on top of each other. And that's what we did. So after hiring a studio to work a whole day, that's what we did. And then we went out and continued walking and talking. I was quite nervous first time I showed this in Rio Cinema. This is from Rio Cinema because the cinema is there. It's a lot of people and the curtain is down. And yeah, you see it happened to be the men and the women, the toilet on each side. And then it's a white vinyl player, and it's just a spot on that player. Is that on? Is that disturbing? No. So what I do is just that I walk up and put the vinyl on, and I thought it's nice that people see it's a vinyl, so you know it's not like an hour of a sound. The vinyl is actually about 20 minutes. And I got to know later on that 22 minutes before they started with much more advertising on American TV was the length that people could concentrate and listen was 22 minutes. And then it happened that you actually can see sound. You put a spot on it like here, and then the reflection makes, when the vinyl turns, movement on the curtain. In the meantime, this is done in quite a few theaters and cinemas. So here I put the vinyl on. And here it should be sound. I think I edited these 22 minutes down to 5. Because I'm so you will find a few jumps, but I think we should listen to it. Okay? Yeah.
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 As you can hear, John, he's a strong poet, but he's an elderly man. He gets really tired, and I get more and more brave. But as I said, we didn't do it at the same time, but it's actually interesting. I find these two friends, these voices, like you talking and walking, like we did this together, what happens between it. Like I said earlier, I was very nervous that people just walk out, just sit in the cinema and the curtain, or theater, and the curtain never opens and you don't see anything, you know, it's no image. But it happened to be that people stay the 22 minutes and we had interesting discussions after. But of course this is a different context, now we're part of a seminar and many other works. Please Return is another voice piece. It's also Sign is part of this piece. I show this icon gallery up in the stairs. It's interesting, I show this quite a few countries and places, and I tend to really, if I do a show, I like this often, the odd places, the strange places, a corner or... this piece has been shown many odd places in museums, and it's the word come, which is also German, Norwegian, and English, quite means the same, come. And I'm doing this shouting, come, by a lake behind my house in Lofoten, which you have the natural echo of five mountains. I thought I should add echo to it later, but nothing is added. The funny thing is that if it's come, if people, I also had when I installed that people who work there, or they come, or do you need any help? People go there to come, but then you just say, please return, you know? Here is just a photo I took myself. I'm on my own with my good recorder, and this is not the head, it's just the, you know, to protect the microphone, the recording microphone from the wind. So here you see the mountain, focus on the mountain, and here you see focus, bit about the echo. Here is a sign from Icon Gallery. And I think this is just a few minutes. I see now you can see it, so we will play that. It's one take.
Come!
my house. It's very steep. It's very physical. It's a no. wait, I have one more piece to show. And of course, to do this echo is also you train the voice. But if it's no snow in winter, I tend to every morning walk up there instead of my other exercise in the morning. It's a very good exercise. And walking, we can have a whole seminar about walking and thinking, and that's part of the work, the way up to the lake and the mountain. This image relates to actually what I said in the beginning of Paul Valéry. I showed this work first time with René Bloch, is a curator that's been important for me. He absolutely wanted to have this on the poster, and I said, no, you show it to me, but now it's okay. Now, in the meantime, relate to what I said earlier, I show this. When I discover the end, I want to live really long. It's the last piece. I have 1 minute left. And it's also 16 millimeter, because I also, this is also up there in the above the Arctic. And I learned when I was in Antarctic filming once that you know, you can't have, and it's very cold, you can't have digital batteries, they run out and so on. But the physicality of actually winding up a film works. Which, in a way, if you don't, John Giorno, the sleep, is actually Andy Warhol's film with John Giorno, where he winds up 20 seconds, the naked man, but it's not embarrassing because every 20 seconds it's not, just as a link to film again. This work, yes, it's about my body, but it's also about the onlooker, because it's installed as this tiny projection. I had it also in Icon, a slightly smaller tunnel, but it's a back projection on film, and you have to walk closely up, so it's very one-to-one experience as well. And it's only 20 seconds. And because of the cold and the environment, the film turns into white. It didn't pass so well in the camera, which is then part of the work.